We continue the Aqeedah, inshallah. يقول المصنف starting from قوله رحمه الله متفرد بالخلق والإرادة. He has his oneness subhanahu wa ta'ala in the creation and his irada, whatever he will and intend subhanahu wa ta'ala and want. وحاكم جل علاه بما أراد وحاكم جل بما أراد. And he decree only whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will. فمنهم الشقي والسعيد. Among his servants are the losers. والسعيد, the one successful or the one who want to be happy. وذا مقرب وذا طريد. And the سعيد is going to be close to Allah, and the other one will be والعياذ بالله expelled from the رحمة of Allah. فقال فمنهم الشقي. So whoever was شقي, that is going to be led astray by the justice of Allah. If the, yeah, that book is 115. The loser is the one who's going to be misled and led astray by the justice of Allah. Now we understand it, right? You understand the four level of the divine will predestination, right? The four level of the divine will and predestination. مراتب القضاء والقدر. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leads astray the one who refused to accept the guidance. One. Allah will not lead astray someone who doesn't know the guidance. So the shaqiyu is going to be led astray by the justice of Allah. No one can come in the day of judgment and say, Ya Allah, I loved you. Ya Allah, I wanted to worship you, but it's you who led me astray. Can someone will say this? So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, leads astray whom he will. What's the meaning of? Allah leads astray whom he will. Say, Ya Allah, if you lead astray whom you will, so why should I work? Or you already, if you decided for this person to be in hellfire, why should he work? Why, you know, gonna be punished? So that's why he said here, قَالَ whoever who's led astray to end up as a loser, is because of his own doing and is done by the justice of Allah. Now, the thing here is very important, because anyone who led astray, there's no unfairness, there's no injustice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah made forbidden the dhulm on himself. وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ. وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ. Subhan. Therefore, only is led astray by the will of Allah the one who refuse to accept the guidance. So Allah leads astray whom he will. So the will, it is the system that we said of the will of Allah that is governing and ruling the way of the universe is functioning. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قال وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِلَّ قَوْمًا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَاهُمْ حَتَّى يُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ مَا يَتَّقُونَ. This is the answer in the Quran. Allah wasn't going to lead astray anyone after he guides them, till he will clarify for them what they need to shield themselves from. So the messenger said, be careful. If you do this, you're going to be punished. And he insists. After insisting, he deserved as a punishment to be led astray. So leading astray here, when he had the blade, is a punishment. Okay, this is a very important part. ومنهم السعيد وهو من وفقه وهداه. And the successful, the one that is going to be fortunate and embraced by the rahmah of Allah, the one who make وفقه, he'll make it easy for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide him to his way. I'm doing the explanation here. So those who are looking for the book, is the last sentence in page 115. The last sentence, قال منهم السعيد وهو من وفقه وهداه. So he's gonna be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's the greatest of the bliss. And the one who had been led astray is going to be far from Allah. So it's a fact. Then he said in the poem, in the nadhm, قال لحكمة بالغة قضاها يستوجب الحمد على قضاها. لحكمة بالغة. All the action of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are coming from His own wisdom. So everything, its source is Allah, is all wisdom. All wisdom. And someone, subhanAllah, will be grateful for every action of Allah, even though he might see it like it gets him or something, that because everything comes from Allah is with hikmah, and everything comes from Allah that it has the hikmah, it requires gratefulness and praise and hamd. That's what he's saying. قَالَ يَسْتَوْجِبُ الْحَمْدُ عَلَى اقْتِضَاهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying in many of the places in the Quran, قَالَ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ. And he had the absolute hamd in the akhirah. Some of the scholars of tafsir, rahimahullah, when you read this ayah, you find that he has absolute the hamd in the akhirah. It includes the people in hellfire making hamd to Allah. So whatever been happening in the earth that people are disputing to say this is injustice, they will be in the torment of hellfire making hamd to Allah. Because they see the evidence and the truth, all what happened to them, it was justice, and all what they missed in Allah from their life, it is to be embraced in the rahmah of Allah. وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ. The people of paradise wa akhiru da'wahum alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, and the people of hellfire, they only blame themselves. And they want to put the blame on someone. They want to put the blame on Iblis. قَالَ فَلَتَلُمُونِ وَلُمُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Don't blame me. Blame yourself. And it didn't have any power on you, except I invited you and you accepted the invitation. Allah wa'adakum wa'ad al-haqqi wa wa'adtukum fa'akhlaftukum. Yes, I acknowledge. Allah promised you the promise of the truth. And I did promise you, but I broke my promise. That's why he is the sheep of the deceiver. قَالَ وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمُ السُّلْطَانِ. But hold on, I didn't have any power on you. I didn't force you. I invited you and you run to me. Lure you with some money, you come like dueling, come and running. You get you. فَلَا تَلُومُونِي. Surah Ibrahim. So don't blame you, blame yourself. And all Allah's action from guidance and misleading is all wisdom, and all of it deserve the hamd. And we already mentioned part of this. Here he's saying, Rahimahullah, if Allah will, He would make the whole humankind obedient. وَلَوْ شَاءَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will. But His wisdom subhanahu wa ta'ala, He made for everyone to have the option and the free will to come willingly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the most important is you come willingly to Allah. Allah can bring you to Him, and everyone is going back to Allah. That's the beauty of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he's talking about the believer, he always gives him the characteristic of being smart. Kays, he thinks. Because all of us, we are servants of Allah, slaves, we belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone refused to go to him willingly, he's gonna come to Allah unwillingly. If the one comes willingly to benefit of the rahmah of Allah and to be showered with the blessing of Allah by willingly asking Allah to help him to be in deep sujood and submission to him, he's going to come in the day of judgment unwillingly in front of Allah. And he wish that he did sujood to Allah. يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ When it's been told them, this is your Lord, make sujood. SubhanAllah. The one who didn't make sujood in this dunya, his back is going to be like stick. He cannot make sujood. That's the true humiliation, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ That's the true humiliation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the smart, believers, you know, they're smart. And these are the best of the creation. He knows that he's going to Allah unwillingly. So he hastened to go to him willingly. That's it, the relation of the obedience and submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that comes from Allah is good. And the evil is the production of the human being. Wallah. But Allah created it. Allah created it. How can you make the difference between the creation of the evil and the source of the evil? Allah created the evil. But who causing the evil is the action of the people. Who causing the evil is the action of the people. Because a hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قُلْ اللَّهُمَ لَبَّيْكَ وَسَعْدَيْكَ وَالْخَيْرُ بِيَدِيكَ وَالشَّرُّ لَيْسَ إِلَيْكَ Come to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am here at your service, at your submitting to you, Allah. The whole good is in your hand. But the evil is not from you, Ya Allah. But the evil is from not from you. In the hadith, for example, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in his opening speech, he said, الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا We seek refuge from Allah, with Allah from the evil of ourselves. The evil of ourselves. So Allah created the evil. As Ibrahim said to his people, والله خلقكم وما تعملون. Some of the scholars give like good definition of that. He said it's like someone enter a grocery store, filled of items. With your cart, you take whatever you want and you leave. This is how human beings they will do. There's the item, this is good action and this bad action. It's all created there. You ask them for the good action, Allah will help you. The other one, you own it by your own self. And you decide to take it. It was there. Allah didn't force you to do it. So the shar, the evil comes from the action of the people who they chose to get it. But they cannot choose to get it if it didn't exist. So the creation is there for them to take it, to commit it, to do corruption and mischief. They chose it. And the other thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His rahmah, and for those who come to Him willingly, He helped them to protect them from the sayyiat. And Allah, from His rahmah, He said, like the angels making, asking forgiveness for His servant. As in Surah Ghafir, قال, the angel, قل ومن تق السيئات يومئذ فقد رحمته. Whoever who helped him to shield himself from the evil, you indeed have showered him with your mercy, Allah. ويستوجب الحمد على اقتضاها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserves the hamd for everything. For everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the evidence of that, you start Surah Al-Fatiha with Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, the absolute hamd. And you don't need to have any good in your hand to say Alhamdulillah. Actually, your state, by being believer, to be allowed to say Alhamdulillah, require hamd. That's why the first thing that you, someone pronounce, say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. We'll move to the next one. قال, page 121, where these are mentioned here. قال, وَهُوَ الَّذِي يَرَى دَلِيبَ الذَّرِّ فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ فَوْقَ صُمِّ الصَّخْرِ. وَهُوَ الَّذِي. Now, we said the Tawheed that he mentioned in this book. You remember the types of the Tawheed, right? The ones we said, the oneness of Uluhiyya, the oneness of Rububiyya, and the oneness of Al-Asma wa Sifat. The oneness of Al-Uluhiyya, the oneness of the Deity, the oneness of Rububiyya, of the Lordship, and the oneness of Al-Asma wa Sifat, the oneness of the names of Allah, beautiful names, and His attributes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the types of oneness. But the scholar here, Musannif, he presented the oneness that how to know Allah. He said there's Ma'rifah wa Ithbat. Ma'rifa, to know Allah with His name, and then ithbat is to confirm the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And both of them are part of the uluhiyya and al-rububiyya, al-uluhiyya, because some of the names are shown Allah's rububiyya and Allah's uluhiyya subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the ithbat also Allah's rububiyya and Allah's greatness subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is from different. So if we said he was Aliyyu Jalidul and he's the only one who created everything, that's to know Allah, then comes here to make ithbat, to confirm his actions subhanahu wa ta'ala, that some of the deviated sect and Ahl al-Bida' they deny. قَالَ وَهُوَ الَّذِي يَرَى دَلِيبَ الذَّرِّ فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ فَوْقَ صُنَّ الصَّخْرِ. He's the one who sees the walking of the small ant on the in the darkness on the smooth rock. He sees subhanahu wa ta'ala and he listens and he knows everything about that ant somewhere on the shore of an ocean, walking in the dark of the night, on a smooth, why قَالَ فِي صَمَّ الصَّخْرِ. He's like, it's so smooth that you cannot hear it at all, because if it's not smooth, you can hear some noise. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees that. He said, وَسَامِعٌ لِلْجَهْلِ وَالْإِخْفَاتِ. And He hears the open and the hidden. Al-jahl, what you can hear loud, wal-ikhfat, can secret. بسمعه الواسع بالأصوات. With his hearing subhanahu wa ta'ala that encompass all the voices. And in these two verses there's إثبات البصر. إثبات البصر. So we confirm the attribute of the seeing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unaware of His creation, or He's not seeing His creation, or like some of those who describe God that he's so great and busy that he doesn't even look at his creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at everything and hears everything. Now, to just grasp this idea of the greatness of the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is distinct from his creation, above his arsh. And he is al-Rahman, so the Rahna. And the scholar, they're saying, the arsh, it is, let's say, the ceiling of the universe. And it is the greatness of the creation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has al-ulu. And his ulu subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we said, without saying how. But it's a fact that he's the, you know, he's the greatest, and he had the attribute of the sublimity, the highest and aboveness of everything. Now, the aboveness of everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala, will be, subhanahu wa ta'ala, have everything under his control. Anything done is under the arsh, right? So, is under Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, power. So imagine every attribute of Allah is muhita, embracing, encompassing everything. Rahma wasi'at kulla shay. Basar sees everything. Hearing, everything is contained, you know, under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing can escape from Allah. So this is إثبات السمع والبصر. This is إثبات السمع والبصر, as he's saying. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ, as he's saying, and to add to that, إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا النِّعِمَّ يَعِظُكُمْ بِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا, in Surah Al-Nisa. And he said in Surah Al-Shura, Ayah 11, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Nothing can be compared or resembling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is the all-hearing, the all-seeing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Hajj, Ayah 61, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يُولِجُ اللَّيْلَ فِي النَّهَارِ وَيُولِجُ النَّهَارَ فِي اللَّيْلِ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ. In Ayah Surah Al-Kahf, قَالَ قُلِ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثُوا. Say, Allah knows how long they stayed. For the people of the cave. لَهُ غَيْبُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. To him belong the unseen of the heaven and the earth. أَبْصِرْ بِهِ وَأَسْمَعْ. أَبْصِرْ بِهِ وَأَسْمَعْ, the scholar they saying, like Ibn Jarir. This is to show how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about himself, that أَبْصِرْ is that he sees everything. وَأَسْمَعْ is that he's the hearer of everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال وتأويل أبصره الله لكل موجود وأسمعه لكل مسموع. Anything that it can be heard, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears. Everything. And everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see it. And here, there's the importance in when you think of the attribute of al-sama' wal-basar, think always of the effect of this attribute on the behavior and the conduct and the belief or the faith of the belief. Because one of the most important things in the Aqidah is to relate what you study with your action in your life. We know Allah hears everything and listening for everything. What is its impact on you as a believer? The impact for a sincere believer is the increase of faith, of safety, and of peace. When Musa alayhi salam and his brother Harun, they had a concern, what if the tyrant Fir'aun go beyond, you know, that's his nature, you know, beyond the norm, and he will kill them. So they will not have the opportunity even to convey the message. What strengthened them? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send to Musa and Harun an army of angels to secure them? He didn't. So what they said? قال كلا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Musa said, and you know, Ya Allah, they already have something against me. Because Musa, a long time ago, before he fled from Egypt, he has, you know, a conflict with one of them and he killed him. So actually, Fir'aun has an excuse to kill Musa. قَالَ ذَرُونِي أَخْتَ مُوسَى Leave me kill Musa عليه السلام. So Musa is in a very difficult situation. What is the power to give to Musa? قَالَ كَلَّا فَاذْهَبَا قَالَ كَلَّا إِنَّنِي مَعَكُمَا أَسْمَعُ وَأَرَى I am with you, I hear and I see. That's the power. So if the believer will have the presence in his heart that Allah is with him. Therefore, he go to defeat fear and increase his faith to have a trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ لِمَعَكُمَ أَسْمَعُ وَأَرَى قَالَ كَلَّ فَاذْهَبَا إِنَّ مَعَكُمَا بِأَيَّتِكَ فَاذْهَبَا بِأَيَّتِنَا إِنَّ مَعَكُمَا مُسْتَمِعُونَ We are with you, we are listening. We are watching everything. Don't think that when you need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because if someone, he knows that he has a whole army behind him, right? And he going to face this difficulty, this person. And he has a device. He said, when I press, just come help me, right? So when he sees himself attacked, he pushed the device. But he was so scared, he's pushing the wrong button. Push, push, nothing is happening. He's gonna faint. But he was secured, he has a whole army, you know, waiting. And they say, and the people that were on the other side, they say, he must be safe. We didn't see any sign. But with Allah, it doesn't help, right? Doesn't work like that. And if he pushed the right button, it's going to take them time to come. And maybe the plot was done to put an obstacle for them to not even get to that place. There's a lot of things. But none of the things have happened with Allah. Huh? إِنَّنِي مَعَكُمْ So, if we think about it as a believer, if they tell you, What if we give you with you, you know, a million of soldiers to help you? Or have Allah with you? What do you think? Need to come from your heart. That if we come to a situation to be safe, to feel safe and comfortable, to have only Allah with us, that's when we start to taste the meaning of the trust in Allah. That's when we come to a point to appreciate the meaning of Sami'un Basir. Sami'un Basir. This is as a fact. The other one, as a fact for the believer, and this is all from the ayat, that you feel Allah is very close to you. Very close to you. Look what he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قَالَ وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْعَزِيزِ الرَّحِيمِ Put your trust on the Almighty, the Beneficent, the Special Merciful. The one الَّذِي يَرَاكَ The one who sees you when you stand to prayer and when you are in your deep sujood. So, سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ Help you when you make dua that you know that Allah is listening. You might be with and around your friends, in a crowded place, and you want to cry to Allah in your heart. Will you say, you know, I need to go alone so someone cannot hear me that I'm calling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when some of the companions, they were like, every time they come, they say, Ya Allah, Allahu Akbar. So, قَالَ اِرْبَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ, you know. Like help yourself. Don't make it tough. You're not calling someone who doesn't hear. إِنَّهُ سَمِيعٌ قَرِيبٌ So سَمِيعٌ, he's listening. قَرِيبٌ, close to you. So the fact that he's listening to you subhanahu wa ta'ala is قَرِيبٌ. And you know the story of Musa alayhi salam when they want to make, you know, they have a drought and ask him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send the rain. You know the story. طيب, they make the dua and everything and no rain came. So Allah, Musa alayhi salam asked, Ya Allah, you know, we did all what we can do. If there's anything. He said, among you, someone who's fighting me with his sins. And this hadith, it has a lot of lessons. طيب. So Musa alayhi salam stood, he said, among us, someone a sinner, can you please leave? You are the one who blocking the rain on us. And the sinner, he's not going to leave among the whole people to be like, pointed this, the one who blocking the rain, that's big, he goes, I don't know. So nobody left. So Musa alayhi salam again make the dua and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the rain. So Musa asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, said, no one left, Ya Allah. What happened? He said, that man made a sincere repentance. So while Musa talking, him himself making dua. And he regretted and he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repentance. And Allah accepted. So he said, Musa was happy. He said, Ya Allah, tell me who this person. At least, you know, I'll go and know him. Tell them now. But he didn't uncover him, was he's a sinner, he wanted to uncover him now that he repented. And this is Sami'un Basir. When you make your dua, even, you know, among million of people, you know that Allah is listening to you. That is a fact, actually. When you see people in the Kaaba, all of one, like, dua, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. No sound or voices will be confused. When people like, you know, especially parents, when their kids, we want to say, hold on, one by one, what do you want? Or someone in the classroom or things, we hold on. So you get mixed up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you call Allah, subhanahu, it's like, you feel like he give you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the whole attention depends on your own sincerity. You're gonna say, Allah, there's someone who is greater pious, so Allah will you know, address his attention to him, not to me. No. If you are in sujood, you say, Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you. That's the ithbat. So those who are denying making ilhad of the names of Allah, they do not know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the way, as a believer, alhamdulillah, to defend our aqeedah. To know our aqidah and to defend it not only from a perspective like just in a way to dispute and argue in type of philosophical way. No, we argue also from a perspective of the need of a life of every human being. Because if you talk to people, if you talk to them about what if your God doesn't listen to you, doesn't know about you, it's hurtful. If you calling an idol that he doesn't know that you exist because he's a stone. He's a stone. Can you imagine someone from, for example, stranded in place of nowhere, in a big storm, cold, and he find a house. He said, this is my refuge. Believing that someone inside the house and will be knocking the horn night with the hope that someone is going to open. But no one, because there's nobody to us. That's how the disbeliever calling his God. وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. There's more say that someone calling other than Allah, that he will not be capable to answer him, or he will not answer until the day of judgment. When he comes to the day of judgment, he finds himself, he was knocking on the wrong door. Can you imagine? When he's dying, he said, but I was calling my God. He said, that's not the right door. That's the wrong door. And then when, look, these attributes, you don't find them in the other faith. Don't God save, Savior, bless. But there's no this description of this attribute to make you feel that when you worship Allah, Allah is subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you. And whoever denies such attributes, he's making ilhad, and whoever he's making ilhad, he's causing himself to be in a state of kufr. So that's why here, when he's saying, وَهُوَ الَّذِي يَرَى, so we have to believe that. دَبِيبَ الضَّرِّ وَالْضُرُمَاتِ فَالْقَصْرَ مِنَ الصَّخْرِ وَسَامِعٌ لِلْجَهْلِ وَالْإِخْفَاتِ بِسَمْعِهِ الْوَاسِعِ الْأَصْوَاتِ. السيدة عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها, وان خولة بنتي ثعلبة, خولة بنتي ثعلبة, she came complaining about this, her situation and what her husband did for her to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the hujra of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was very small. So Aisha was behind the curtain in a corner, and this is in Sahih al-Bukhari. She said, and Khawla was in the same room. She said, I heard part of her speech and many of the parts I didn't hear in the very room. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم didn't have an answer. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the ayah, قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا. Allah indeed heard the saying of the lady, the woman who's complaining and disputing, arguing about the situation, her situation with her husband. This ayah, how many people, when you read it, we only think of the ruling of a vihar. Huh? But in it, to one of the greatest lesson of Aqidah. The first lesson is Allah's hearing, listening to you, whatever you make dua. When you have a problem, know the closest, instead of pick up the phone to call someone to share with him or with her your anxiety, your problem, the closest is Allah, already knows about you. The other thing, and this is so beautiful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest, He takes care of everything. For example, when we're talking about a king or a president, say at the door there's a lady who complaining about her husband. Okay, she go to the court, why is she coming here? I mean, the king, I have big business to deal with, huh? And subhanAllah, this is what we call the positivism and the way of in the aqidah of Islam, which is you don't have a limit in the hope you have in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot say, oh, this dua, it's Allah will not take care of it because it's nothing, I mean, it's not important. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rahim with all His creation. Even a woman who has a household problem, Allah solve it. That's the ijabiyya. And subhanAllah, in the other faith, they don't have this hope. They don't have this ijabiyya, which is everything positive about Allah. Everything great when we talk about Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not decline or neglect any of His creation. Any caller. قال Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وَجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَى. He called the da'i, any caller. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next one that we need to take care of as effect of السَّمْعُ وَالْبَصَرُ, the attribute of Sam'a wal Basar, is also to be watchful of ourselves. So it's increase of power and faith, give you the sense of the closeness to Allah, but at the same time, Allah knows what you do. So fear Him. So in the Sam'a wal Basir, just to be mindful of them, help you to be have taqwa, closeness to Allah and power. Defeat your fear, close to Allah, and have taqwa by watching yourself. Because you need to be ashamed from Allah if you do things that it doesn't please Him. Like there's Hadith Qudsi, the meaning, Allah talked to the old people. He said, be ashamed from me as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shy. He doesn't want to punish you when you do such a thing. And then comes to the next attribute, which is the knowledge of Allah. The knowledge of Allah. وَعِلْمُهُ بِمَا بَدَى وَمَا خَفِي أَحَاطَ عِلْمًا بِالْجَلِيِّ وَالْخَفِي وَعِلْمُهُ. And the knowledge of Allah of everything that is seen, apparent, and everything that is hidden or unseen. أَحَاطَ, the same verb. So is encompass everything, subhanAllah. So one of the name of Allah is Al-Muhit. Ahata bi kulli shay'in ilm. So he knows everything. And the knowledge of the human being they have is like an infinite small compared to the absolute and infinite knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أحاط علما بالجلي والخفي. So he's encompassed and he had the knowledge of everything that's seen and unseen, apparent and hidden. And this is one of the sifat that Allah confirmed to himself. أثبته الله سبحانه وتعالى ورسوله. There's a lot of ayahs about that. Shu'ayb, وَسِعَ رَبُّنَا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything that exists that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about. Ibrahim alayhi salam, in his dua, رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ تَعْلَمُ مَا نُخْفِي وَمَا نُعْلِمُ وَمَا يَخْفَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. You know everything we hide and everything we disclose. And nothing can be hidden from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, the impact of the attribute of knowledge in the life of a believer is also substantial. Every name, if you take it and you try to translate it into action, by thinking and reflecting on its impact on your behavior, someone subhanAllah will change all his life. وفي الصحيحين عن جابر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعلم أصحابه الاستخارة. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to teach his companion al-istikhara. And the istikhara, subhanAllah, based on you asking Allah's knowledge to decide for you. And that's the true submission, if you know the greatness and the meaning of Allah's knowledge, subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ إِذَا هَمَّ أَحَدُكُمْ بِالْأَمْرِ فَلْيَرْكَعْ رَكْعَتَيْنِ مِنْ غَيْرِ الْفَرِيضَةِ ثم ليقل اللهم إني أستخيرك بعلمك. والله I ask you with your knowledge and أستقدرك بقدرتك, help me with your power, وأسألك من فضلك العظيم and ask you from your tremendous bounties. فإنك تقدر ولا أقدر. You have the power and I don't have. وتعلم ولا أعلم. And here subhanAllah testimony of submission. So if you acknowledge that Allah knows and you do not know, so what follow this, it need to follow the submission to whatever befall on you after that. Al-istikhara is not about to get what you want. Al-istikhara is about to submit to whatever is going to befall on you. You understand? If you have something in your mind and you don't know is good for you or not, and you make the istikhara. So why did you do the istikhara? For Allah to choose for you, because He knows that you do not know. So do not make the istikhara for Allah to give it to you. That's not the meaning of the istikhara. Because if you want it, don't make the istikhara. Say, Ya Allah, I love this, give it to me. But if you make istikhara, you need to free your heart from that want. Why? Because you said, Ya Allah, you know and I do not know. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala move it away from you, what does it mean? That Allah knows that is not good for you. So you're going to be happy but by not having it. Because you trust the knowledge of Allah. عَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌّ لَكُمْ تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. You might like something that is bad for you. So how do you know that is bad? You don't know. So I say, أَسْتَخِيرُكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِعِلْمِكَ. I'm asking you with your knowledge, Ya Allah. So if Allah chose to you, this need to be your happiness in Allah chose for you, not in getting what you want before you make the dua. That is the istikhara. And this is the impact of us behaving according to the attribute of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the meaning of when we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the all knowledge. So if you have the all knowledge, how can you not trust Him? So if you want something that you don't know is going to be good for you or not, an opportunity to make millions. But what will help you to make millions if it's going to end up for someone to be cast in hellfire? So you say, Ya Allah, if this is good for me, choose it for me. If it's not, take it away. And after you make the dua, everything is gone. He said, Alhamdulillah. But not someone will be sad. He said, I wish I didn't make the dua. So you're not with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you should not have made the dua. Because some people will, you know, repent. You know the story of the one who repented. And sincere repentance, the more his iman increases, he has like a lot of cattle of goats. You know this? So the more he increases in iman, every time he makes two rak'ah, one goat dies. One goat died. It's a big trial. Another rak'ah, another goat died. So he was confused. So in the end of the night, there's only one goat left. And he tried to concentrate what you're going to do. And the goat is like, keep making sound. So he said, are you going to stop or going to hit you with two rak'ah? Or is it joke? But do you know why? Every time he prays, a goat died. It is rahmah or punishment. It's rahmah. Because originally all the goat he has is from haram money. So every time he's close to Allah, Allah gets him rid from the haram. You don't have to kill it. Allah is taking it away. Allah is taking it away from him. That's why when someone making dua for Allah to help him, and Allah knows all what he has is from haram, that's he's taking him to hellfire. After he makes sincere repentance, the next day he has a bankrupt. And this is his trial. It's a trial Allah is helping him. Because if you tell him, for example, someone say, I want to repent. Someone, he wants to go to Hajj. He came to a sheikh, he told him, I want to repent. I never paid my zakat. He told him, you didn't? He said, no. He told him, okay, bring what you have. So they were calculating the whole night. He told him, you have to pay this amount. He's a big businessman. He told him, this? He told him, yes. He told him, no, no, I changed my mind. He could not bear to pay that zakat. He decided to not go to Hajj. Why? Because he wasn't capable, not capable, he has money. But for him it was like too much. He's like, there's no discount in zakat. That doesn't belong to you. So, this is a true story. People of town, they went to Hajj. When they came back from Hajj, that person passed away. He had the opportunity to repent and to wash all his sins away. But because of that money, no. He died before even people get back from the Hajj. Not paying any penny of zakat. So what that money helped him at that moment is gone. These people, Allah give them rahmah. Sincerely repent. If you can't tell him, he asks you, what should I do? I said, okay, you need to get rid of the haram. Said, what haram? All my fortune, I made it from the haram. I cannot. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped him by getting through trial to take away that money, you know, against his will, but actually is the biggest rahmah that Allah has given him. His biggest rahmah. But Allah will help him by filling his heart with contentment. Then after he will hold a little bit with patience, then everything will be fine for him. Because Allah is going to make him live the joyful life that he promised him. And this is one of the effects of al-alim. So when you make the istikhara, and the Prophet ﷺ taught us that, is our knowledge in the attribute of and the name of Allah of al-alim. If you really trust Allah, then ask Allah to help you accept what is going to befall on you next. Not to beg Allah to give you what you want. Because you don't know what you want, that it might not be good for you. I will stop here. Or just finish with one remark. He's saying here, there's five keys of the unseen. Only Allah knows them. Only Allah knows them. These five keys of the unseen mentioned in the end of Surah Luqman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Surah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثَ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. Five. Only Allah knows. The coming of the hour comes all of a sudden. The coming of the ghayth, the rain, with all the forecast that they have, that the way that Allah yusarrifuhu, He distributed in the way that Allah will. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ. And he knows whatever in the wombs. مَا is not men, because they said, oh, you said this is key of the unseen, only known by Allah. Now in the medicine, they can't detect, you know, if it's a boy or a girl. He said, yes, if Allah said men, who in the womb, he didn't say who, he said na, whatever in the arham, include his way of thinking, his characteristic, his personality, his psychology, how he going to end, everything Allah knows, since that, you know, newborn is in the baby in the womb of his mom. Ma fil arham, only Allah knows. And you find, subhanAllah, twins, and they are totally different. They look alike, but everyone thinks different way. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا. No one will know how we want to be doing tomorrow. And no one knows when he's going to die or where he's going to die. That's in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those are مفاتيح الغيب. وعندهم مفاتيح الغيب لا يعلمها إلا هم. in the hadith لا يعلم ما في غد إلا الله ولا يعلم ما تغيب الأرحام إلا الله ولا يعلم ما يأتي المطر أحد إلا الله ولا تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت ولا يعلم متى تقوم الساعة إلا الله. The five that we mentioned in the ayah. One of the scholars he saw in a dream and the angel of death. And he's in Medina and he loves to die in Medina. To the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever among you who came to die in Medina, he will do it. But actually in the hand of Allah. So he saw the angel of death and he told him, do you know when I'm going to die? So he gave him the sign, five. So he woke up so bewildered. He doesn't know 5 days, 5 hours, 5 months, 5 years. He was so, he could not even move from his house. Maybe it might be 5 hours or he's going to die. So he sent his servant to one of the main scholars from the big Tabi'in, Ibn Sirin. He's the one who knows, known by the interpretation of the dreams. He told him, go to tell him, it's not five time, specific time. Five is the keys of the unseen. So like angel of death, he tell him, I don't know. He asked me, I do not know. Only Allah knows. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakum Allah khair. Any question about the... for you don't know if it's good or not. A job, marriage, you don't know. You don't know if it's good. It's halal. You cannot make istikhara for something haram. No. That is forbidden to ask actually. Because the haram will never turn to be good at all. If it wasn't, if Allah made it haram, so it'll never be good. Any question?
Ask question. Can you make istikhara like, if you don't have a decision? Like usually they say like pray istikhara, like if you have a decision you want Allah to guide your decision. But how about if you're like confused about two options?
Istikhara is once a morning, yes, more than one option. Or one thing that he asked Allah to choose for him. But after making the istikhara, he will have a decision according to his own skills and knowledge. And Allah, He will guide him. For example, offer of two jobs. You know, both of them are good. You make the istikhara. You don't know which job is going to be beneficial for you, for your deen and for. But both of them, they seem good. Then, you need to give equal, you know, effort for both of them. Same good resume, same effort. They call you for the interview, you go and your answer is like this. So you make every one of them is like, that's the one. But then you end up with one. Know that one is Allah who helped you to get it. And then you feel like you make a decision, you say, no, I don't feel good about this thing. So it's easy make someone to make easy decision. Because he said, you know, this job, you know, it might have a trouble and everything, you know, I don't want it, I'll do this. So you're thinking of what is going to be the schedule of your prayer, what is going to be the family. It's all of things like thinking of the decision who helped you to take a decision from the side of your deen, of your integrity. And then that's the decision will be easy after the istikhara because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped you to make it clear to you. And Allah guide you. Any other questions? I'll give you 5 minutes just to grab the file for the hadith and come back.
And then
we talk about the exam, inshallah, if you're going to.